Thank you, Mr. John.
And thanks to each of the good men who led us in worship so far tonight. It's an honor and a privilege to stand before you. So glad to see you. So glad to be with you. Did you hear about, Eric this morning talked about a certain congressman that he was hobnobbing with last week. But I heard about a congressman who goes into the pizza parlor and orders a pizza. And so the clerk says, you want that in 6 pieces or 8 pieces? He said, I'm pretty hungry. I think I'll take 8 pieces. Well, I mean, that's the way Congress thinks, I guess. So we've had a good day, and I don't know who won the race. I fell asleep trying to watch the thing, but if anybody knows, you can tell me afterward. But there was this race where they were turning left at every corner, round and round, and I saw a little bit of it on TV. I also saw some Elvis, and guess what? I watched more of that than I did. It was the Hawaii concert from 1973, satellite broadcast live, and it was making history. And I was telling Jim about it, and he asked me, did I get up and do some of the wiggling around? And I said, he had outgrown that by then. He didn't do that anymore by that time. All right, let's get started. Let's get down to business. You know what I told Warren? I said, Warren, you know when I miss you most? And he said, yeah, when I'm not here. And I said, that's right. So we're glad to see you, Warren. Each spring and each fall, our students go on campaigns. And churches invite us to come in groups. And so last week was campaign week. But one church, they chickened out at the last minute. Somehow they didn't have their act together. And so we were left with a gang of students and no place to take them. And one of them, Travis Bookout, traveled from Monroe, Louisiana, where he's the preacher at the church called Atlanta something. He's a distance learning student, and so he was going to be on campaign. Anyway, we turned it into a mission seminar during the mornings, and then during the afternoons, we went out and did Christian service. And so they went to widows' houses, and they raked leaves, and they did yard work, and they did some painting, and they went to nursing homes and sang, and they did all kinds of good things. This lady is our cook, our cafeteria lady. This man is our dean of students, one of our and faculty members. Everyone else there is a student. This young man is from the island of Antigua in the Caribbean, and he's a super good guy. This is the student I told you about that ran wide open into a tree and had a concussion, not a tree, but a steel post up at CYC at Gatlinburg. And it not only did it hurt him when he hit the steel post, but then he fell back and fell on another thing, some other kind of piece of steel, and so he had them both. Anyway, he missed about 2 weeks of school, and he's still a little wobbly. You'll notice he's holding on to another one of the students there, but he's been cleared by the doctors, and he's going to be okay. It's just going to take him a little bit more time. Okay, from time to time, I give you these statistics, and I'm doing this for a different reason tonight, but these are our 2013 Christian Service statistics at Heritage, and I won't. These are the sermons preached and all that, and then the result of this work is prayer requests: 1,542, 342 baptisms, and then 317 restorations. Now we're talking about restoration, rededication, restart, beginning again. I remember seeing a movie one time, a good movie called Begin Again, Finnegan. And it was about this guy by the name of Finnegan who's the love of his life died in their old age. And he thought his life was over. And for a while, it just seemed like it was. But then after a couple of years, he started to get out and socially speaking and all that. Started riding the same bus every day to go into town and met a lady on the bus. And he wound up deciding that he could begin again in life, start anew. And so we're talking about this, but of course we're doing it from a spiritual perspective. And so last week, and I'm just going to review quickly what we've already talked about, we saw some warnings to Christians that it is possible to turn away from the living God, Hebrews 3:12-13. It is possible to reject the faith or for our faith to become shipwrecked, 1 Timothy 1:18-19. And it is possible that some, 1 Timothy 4:1, will abandon the faith. And so it is a reality. And then we looked at a case study last week, and that's Simon the Sorcerer. We'll get back to that in just a little while. And then we asked the question that my grandson asked back a few years ago when he was a little kid and before he was baptized, and he was looking forward to the day when he would be baptized. And then he asked this question as we were, as a family, riding in the van, his family van. I have to be driving. He said, "What if I mess up?" Which is a good question, you know, for this is a good innocent question for a little boy to ask. What if I become a Christian and then I mess up? And really, that's a question that all of us need to entertain from time to time, because the Bible says in Galatians 5:4 that it's possible to fall away from grace. This morning, Eric was talking about how that we need to grow in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's where we all need to be. But what if we fall away from grace? And then James 5:19 and 20 says this: "My brothers and sisters, if one of you," meaning someone in the church, "should wander away from the truth, and someone should bring that person back." That's called restoration. If someone being restored to the Lord. "Remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover a multitude of sin." And then there's that solemn warning in 1 Corinthians 10:12 that says, "If you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall." In other words, that verse is designed to remind us that we shouldn't get smug and so self-confident. Now, you can't have too much confidence in the Lord, but we can have too much confidence in our own ability to navigate all the temptations that Satan puts in front of us. And so he says, just know that it is possible to stumble and fall, and so be careful is what he's saying. I'm sorry, I didn't get to that yet, did I? Yes, I did. I'm back on track now. What does it mean to be unfaithful? I think the best way to understand what it means to be unfaithful is to have a clear understanding of what it means to be faithful. Because if we have a clear understanding of what it means to be faithful, then we'll know that unfaithfulness is just the opposite of what faithfulness is. So 1 Timothy 3:12, this is NIV, "A deacon must be faithful to his wife and must manage his children and his household well." And I realize New King James Version says it slightly differently. It says a deacon must be the husband of one wife, but it basically means staying true to the one that you've committed yourself to. And then Matthew 25:14-30 is a good way for us to understand what faithfulness is. So if we understand what it is, then we want to make sure that we stay in that, on that path, and that we do not wander away from it and commit the opposite of faithfulness, which would be unfaithfulness. Matthew 25:14. "Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability." Now that's a godly way of treating everyone equally. But because you see, yes, he gave more to some than he did to others, but he said it's according to each person's ability. "Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them." Now, that's a sobering statement right there. The master returns and settles accounts. And you know, of course, that the spiritual meaning of that is that Jesus will come back one of these days, and then we're all going to judgment. We're all going to judgment day, and accounts will be settled in. Verse 20, "The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5 and said, 'Master, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, 'Well done, good and faithful servant.'" So right away we see the definition of faithfulness, and that is to be good stewards of what God has entrusted within our care. And as a result of that, he says, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with two bags of gold came also and said, Master, you entrusted me with two bags of gold. See, I have gained two more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. By the way, that to me is an exciting sort of, if you read between the lines there, here's what I think we're learning by reading this, is that God is going to give us a blessed and exciting and challenging eternity. Where he says, if you will be faithful with a few things here on earth, I'm going to give you all. He says, you can't imagine. Your ear has never heard, your eyes never seen, it's never even entered into your thoughts and your imagination, the wonderful things I'm going to entrust within your care and keeping over on the other side. So he says, well done, good and faithful servant. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received one bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew you are a hard man, harvesting where you've not sown, gathering where you've not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. Now, right away, we're seeing the difference between faithfulness and unfaithfulness. Unfaithfulness has to do with being wicked and lazy and not taking care of the things that God has left within our care and keeping, the things He's entrusted to us. And so He says, you wicked and lazy servant, so you knew that I harvest where I've not sown and gather where I've not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I return, I would have received it back with some interest. In other words, you have not been faithful. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken away from them. And throw what is worthless, that worthless servant, outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now, he's not saying that he's going to take wealth away from poor people. He's not even talking about wealth, because this has spiritual application. And he's basically saying that people who are faithful will be given even more things to be faithful over, talking spiritually again, and people who can't be trusted with God's precious treasure, which is His truth, His gospel, that even that will be taken away from them. And so here's a good question. Do I have to be perfect in order to please God? Do I have to be perfect in order to go to heaven? And the answer to this is, are you ready? No. Why would I say no? Because you can't be perfect. No one could go to heaven if we have to be perfect on our own and of our own strength. That's why the Bible says in Romans 3, verse 10, there is none righteous, no, not one. And again in verse 23, for all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. And so, one thing we know is that we cannot save ourselves. And so, when we ask ourselves the question, do I have to be perfect in order to be faithful? It's kind of like you've heard me and other preachers say, I can't be a perfect husband, but I can be a faithful husband. And we understand what that means. So, no, we don't have to be perfect because we can't. And Paul even admits that he's not perfect. And he is one of those who constantly reminds us of our responsibility to be faithful. But he says this in Romans chapter 7, verse 14 and following. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is, no longer I myself who do it, but the sin is living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. He means perfectly. He doesn't mean that he can't do good. He just means that I cannot do it perfectly. Verse 19, for I do not do the good that I want to do, but the evil that I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Verse 20, now if I do what I do not want to do. It is no longer I who do it, but it is the sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? And then if you keep reading, he goes right in, we call it chapter 8, he goes right into saying there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. In other words, the who will rescue me is answered in the first verse of chapter 8, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I should say. But the Bible says that we do have a problem, and it's called sin. 1 John 3:4, everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. And again, the scripture says all of us have sinned. And so can we know if we are unfaithful? And the answer is yes. I mean, just look at the works of the flesh listed in Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21. We are aware if we are involved in any of these things. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. And so, you know, it would be hard to misunderstand that. We know that this kind of behavior is unfaithful behavior. And then again, Galatians 5:4, you who are trying to be justified by the law, meaning the law of Moses, the Old Testament, have been alienated from Christ and you have fallen from grace. We know if we are trusting in the Lord or if we're trusting in some sort of system that has been done away with and taken away from us, such as the law of Moses. We're aware of that. Matthew 7:21, Jesus says this: not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And so we know when we're not doing God's will. Hebrews 10:25, this has to do with attendance in worship. Not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And then 1 John 5:16, if you see any brother or sister commit a sin that does not lead to death, you should pray, and God will give them life. I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There is a sin that leads to death. I am not saying that you should pray about that. And by the way, I want to talk more about this in just a moment, but he's basically saying, don't pray for a person who is not willing to repent, because they are involved in sin that it leads to death. But he says, you show me someone who is willing to repent, confess, and they want to get right with the Lord. He says, pray for a person like that. You can save a soul. You can help save a soul that way. And so we want to be in the soul saving business. And so, yes, we can know when we're unfaithful, just like we can know if we are faithful. Well, how does God describe unfaithfulness? Well, he says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, this is talking about the church at Laodicea. He says, you've left your first love, or you have forsaken the love you had at first, the NIV says. And so, basically, if we have fallen out of love with the Lord, if our love has grown cold, if we no longer have a zeal for what's good and what's right and what's holy and pure, and that doesn't even attract us anymore, he says, you've left your first love. And then he says this in John chapter 15, verses 5 and 6. And I realize this is not exactly the same thing as what I've just now said, but it contributes to it. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. And then listen to these next words. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And so we are unfaithful if we find ourselves apart from the Lord. And then 1 Timothy 5:6 says it's like a dead man walking. Now, he's actually talking about widows who are living for pleasure, but he says she's dead even while she lives. And then the most graphic description of unfaithfulness is found In 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 20 and 22, if they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that means they have become Christians and they have been forgiven of their sins, and are again entangled in it and are overcome, they are worse off in the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and then turned their backs on the sacred command that was passed on to them. Of them the proverbs are true: a dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed returns to her wallowing in the mud. And so that's how the scripture describes unfaithfulness. So here's a good question. Will God allow me to restart my life if I allow the relationship between the Lord and me to deteriorate? Will he allow me to hit the reset button and to start all over? And the answer is yes. Yes, yes. 2 Corinthians 7:10 says, godly sorrow brings repentance. You show me someone who is truly sorry for the fact that they have allowed their faith to become shipwrecked. You show me someone who is truly sorry that they have drifted away from the Lord. You show me someone who is ashamed and embarrassed that they have allowed Satan to take them away from a good, close relationship with the Lord. And this scripture says that is the motivation for repentance. And repentance, of course, is absolutely necessary in order for us to be saved. And then there's Acts 8, 12 through 24 again. This is Simon the sorcerer. And we've already talked about him. And he was told in verse 22, repent of this thy wickedness and pray to the Lord in the hope that that you will be forgiven, and that he may forgive you, I should say. And then, of course, Simon replied, pray to the Lord for me, verse 24. Okay, now let's read the old story one more time. This is Luke chapter 15, and I'm reading verse 11 and following. Because when you ask the question, will the Lord allow me to restart, this story answers the question. Yes, he will. Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all that he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to the fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father. And I will say to him, father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy. He's rehearsing his speech, you see. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him and ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. And the father cuts off his speech that he had rehearsed there. And the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Why? Because God will allow us to restart. He will take us back. And we need to realize this is taught in many ways and in many places in Scripture. For instance, this is James 5:16. Hold on. I think maybe I messed up there. I've got four pieces of paper up here, and now I'm back on track. Everybody, just calm down, okay? So, here's a good question. How do we go about restarting? Because if we can restart, if God will allow us to restart, how do we go about, what's the process? Well, again, remember this from Acts chapter 8, verses 20 and 24. Simon the sorcerer was told to repent and pray. And then this is 1 John chapter 1, verses 7 through 9. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us from all unrighteousness. And then James 5:16. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Now, last week I was talking with a brother here, and the question was asking me, what about preachers? Do they ever need to be restored, do they ever need to confess fault? Now, I'll tell you, I confess most of my faults during my sermons. I'll say, you know, I'm guilty of this, and I'll talk because I just like to keep it real. I have this preacher friend who was a white guy, but he was speaking to an all-black church in the South back a few years ago. I know him, and he told me this story, and he said that he got into this verse, and he was saying, you know, we preachers, all of us are sinners, preachers, everyone else. And he said, for instance, and he started listing some of his faults. He says, you know, I can be covetous, and the church said, mm-hmm. And he says, and I can be envious, and they said, yes. He said, I've been, you know, sometimes I can be jealous, and yes. And he keeps on naming sins until finally just kind of struggling for what else is he going to say. And one little old lady in the audience says, come clean, preacher. In other words, tell it all. So the question was asked to me, well, what do preachers do? Do they go to other preachers, or do they, you know, do they go to elders? And my answer is, preachers, in my opinion, ought to do just what everybody else in the church does, and that's come clean. And as a matter of fact, one of my guys, one of the men who works for me, tells a story about when he first started preaching, and he was a guest speaker at a little country congregation. And so he hadn't preached more than two or three sermons in his life. So he gets up there and he offers his sermon, and then he extends the invitation, and they had one response. You want to guess who it was? The preacher. And my friend didn't know what to do with him, you know. And so he looked at him like, well, you know what? So the preacher leaned up and said, just ask me to sit down. So he said, you want to sit down? He said, yeah. And so he sits down. And so the invitation song is over, and the preacher, my guy just stands there like, he don't know what to do. So the preacher says, come sit beside me, you know. And so he comes and sits beside him, and the preacher said, you're supposed to ask me now what you can do for me. And he said, well, what can I do for you? He said, I want to confess fault. He said, I need to be restored. And he said, I want to ask you to handle my, you know, to tell the church that I want to be restored, and I'm confessing fault, and I'm asking for the prayers of the church. And so my friend did that. He was nervous as could be because he thought, well, preachers? I mean, preachers need to confess fault? Well, yes, everybody needs to confess fault. Flip Wilson, that is if you are at fault, you understand. Flip Wilson, he used to have the church of what's happening now, you know, in his comedy show. You remember this when he did it one time? He was acting like he was the right high reverend or whatever, and he was telling people they need to confess, confess, confess. He kept preaching. And so finally people started responding and confessing. And one guy said he'd been guilty of stealing, and he said, that's what you need to do, confess. And another guy said he'd been lying. He said, that's what you need to do, confess. Somebody else confessed that he was been running around with a deacon's wife, and Flip said, I don't believe I told that. In other words, you can go too far, not necessarily. But But it's very important for us to make sure that we're coming clean with the Lord. But I don't know, people ask me this question, and I've been asked this recently, how much should you tell about your sins? And the truth is, I don't know, but I think you need to tell enough that you know you have done the right thing. And of course, if sins are private, then I don't know of any use in making them public. If you feel like that will strengthen you spiritually, then I wouldn't discourage you from doing that. If your sin is between, for instance, if I offend Glenn in some way, well, you know, I need to go to Glenn, and I need to make it right with Glenn. And I might not necessarily need, but now if it creates a dissension and trouble in the church and it gets public and he and I have an argument and it's loud and I say some things I ought not say, then I feel like, Dennis feels like, that he ought to come clean in front of the church and say, brethren, I was wrong. I confess I was wrong. I did not treat my brother right. And I want to repent of this, and I'm confessing it honestly, and I want to pray for forgiveness, but I want to ask you to pray with me for forgiveness as well. And so, you know, that's I've done it. I've actually responded to the very invitation I was offering. I remember one time back a few years ago when I was working with the Rogersville Church, I'd had a rough week, and my attitude had gotten all out of whack. And I'm up here, it's on Wednesday night during the devotional, and I felt myself being convicted of my own sin. I was encouraging other people to get right with the Lord if they needed to. And so I said, you know what, folks? I said, I want to be the first one. I said, maybe I'm the only one, but I want to be the first one to respond to the invitation tonight. And I want to ask you to pray with me. I said, my attitude has not been good this week. And I know that some of the ways I've interacted with some of you has not been, I've just not had my attitude right, my heart right. And I want to repent of that. And I'm just confessing, I want to get right with the Lord and I want to be right with you. About 50 people responded that night. I was the first one, but about 50 people responded. Why? Because I guess they said, well, if this preacher is going to be that honest, maybe I ought to be too, you see. But again, I wonder sometimes if it's necessary to tell everything that could be. Just last week in the news, I don't know what network, I don't remember. I'm a channel flipper, but they were talking about how that there are 9 electrical substations in the United States. And if you can sabotage these 9 electrical substations, you can close down the whole country. You can shut off all the electricity in the country. And they had this map up here showing the terrorists and the other bad guys where the substations are. And I'm saying, why do you need to tell all that? Some things just don't need to be told. Why give? That's TMI. That's too much information. So, I don't know. Can you offer too much information? I don't know. But I do know this. Proverbs 28:13. Whoever conceals their sins does not prosper. But the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. And so we need to be people who not only are willing to repent and confess and pray for forgiveness, but we need to be the kind of people who are always seeking mercy. You know, and I've told you this before, and I know I'm not the only one, but every time we have communion on Sunday morning, I always take communion with this attitude, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Because if I review the past week, even in my thought life or whatever, I know I've not been perfect. And so I just want to be honest with the Lord. Have mercy on me, a sinner. Well, how many restarts do you get? That's a good question, don't you think? Now, here is the preacher answer. Are you ready for this one? I've been studying this for 2 weeks now. How many restarts do you get? I don't know. That's the answer. I don't know. But I do know that God is abundant in His mercy and that He desires that all of us be saved, 1 Timothy 2:4. And so I'm guessing that as many times as we will honestly repent and confess our fault and ask for forgiveness, that's how many times the Lord will allow us to restart. So I like what's said in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. But because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages He might show the incomparable riches of His grace expressed in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And so God is a God of great love. He's rich in mercy, and He expresses His grace by His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And so how many restarts do you get? I think you can get as many as you need, as long as we are honest and we're not and we're sincere, and we're not you might say playing the Lord, because you can't play the Lord. He knows us. He knows all about us. Here's the gospel plan of salvation tonight, reminding us that we need to hear the gospel and believe it and repent of our sins, confess our faith in Jesus, and receive baptism in order to become a Christian. Now, all this sermon up until this point has been to people who are already Christians, who have already obeyed these commands. But if you've not obeyed these commands, then tonight is the best opportunity you'll ever have to become a Christian and to receive baptism for the forgiveness of sin. If you've already obeyed these commands, but your relationship with the Lord is not what it ought to be, then this sermon tonight has been designed to help you understand and appreciate the opportunity to restart by repenting, confessing fault, and praying for forgiveness. And if necessary, and most of the time I think it is, we need to ask our church family to pray with us and for us, that we may be forgiven and restored to the Lord. Tonight, if you need to come for any reason, won't you come now while together we stand and sing?